everybody, and welcome to Art Classes My Way. And we are back with the Harlequin Duck. As you can see, he's pretty much finished at this point. Nothing big that you guys missed. It's just the exact same techniques up here that I did down here in the moss. Now, as far as this rock goes, in order to get the texture that I did end up getting with it, let me fan brush here. I just used this smaller fan brush, and it's the exact same fan brush that I used up in here to get the illusion of the feathers, but I did it in multiple directions, spinning it with just a slightly darker shade of blue than what I was using throughout. And even then, you can see in this very blue area, there's hardly any kind of speckling or peebling going on in here. And that's totally fine, because that was pretty much the exact same shade of blue that I used throughout to get a more granity, softer rock, a rock that's been worn away by a lot of water over time, and just kind of spinning this guy as opposed to the duck, where we very specifically were following a very particular set of lines on his chest. Here, just nice, trying to keep it nice and even all the way through. Really, that was the biggest technique that you missed. And just making this guy dance right on the tips of his bristles. Now, it's going to be pretty hard to do with a fan brush that's very, very soft. This guy's got a little bit of stiffness to him. And that's why I like having a nice variety of super soft brushes that they don't bounce quite like this guy does. They just go, maybe a little bit of bounce. But this guy, he's got some good bounce on him. I can't figure any other way to show you how stiff he is. You know, you don't know how much pressure I'm actually putting into this, because you guys are in TV land at the moment. Or computer land, whatever, wherever you happen to be watching from. But it's just dancing along the tips. And even if I held my paintbrush straight up, the bristles aren't even bowing at all. But I mean, overall, as opposed to something like a oil brush, this guy is pretty soft. But overall, yeah. It's got some bounce to him. As opposed to my round here, that has... Actually, he's pretty stiff too. I guess it's one of my other round brushes. Oh well. So, in this video, I'm pretty much going to be covering some of the mistakes and little tweaking things here and there that I myself do need to work on for this little guy. And that is, I got a little bit silly with how dark I got this area, and I need to lighten it up. And this little patch here, in the picture that I took of it once I got, I knew there was still something wrong and I still needed to tweak. But that night I was done. It's, you know, 99% done. They sent the picture out to a few people and they all pretty much said, what is this? So clearly this I need to work on, because this is a lichen. I'm not sure if it's classified as a fungus or not. I just know it's called a lichen. And lichens are, if you look up Northwest rocks, mosses and lichens, this is that kind of weird little thing that, you know, sometimes it appears in very small patches on a rock, and it kind of looks like a fungus. I don't know how to describe it. Sometimes it looks like it's a part of the rock, but parts of the rock that have been discolored. Type it into Google, lichens on rocks, and you'll see it, and you'll know instantly what I'm talking about, because you've all seen it, and just about any Ireland, or mossy place anywhere in the country. We all see it in movies, and it's what makes a gorgeous fictional woodland setting what it is. It's an awesome little thing that we all take for granted. Lichens are pretty darn cool. But this lichen is, he needs a little bit more work. And lichens can appear in several different colors. In the photo of the rock that I was using for this, it was very, very minty. And when I got done, it's like, okay, this whole area felt really too pale and washed out. Like I used a flash with this. I wasn't very happy with that, so I knew there was some work to be done, but in my research to try to figure out how to fix this guy, which, again, the stippling technique is the exact same thing with the fan brush. It's just round, 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 and then being a little bit heavier in some of the areas where there were a few more line-like areas or shadowing areas. But lichens can also appear very rusty. So I think that's what I'm going to try to do, is to bring some of this gorgeous warm sienna down into here, because then that'll, you know, help with this area not seeming like the only sienna area, even though we've used it in these areas back here. Now that it's up front, it's like stopped. So we're going to bring a little bit of it down this direction. And this guy, we're going to lighten him up in a few areas, because this is where the sun is coming this direction. That's why his head's mostly bright right here. I might touch some of this area up with just a little bit more white. We'll see. But the sun is coming from here over. So I'm pretty happy with the shadowing. If anything, maybe I'll add some more dark just in here, in the side of this moss. But over here, I'm thinking some yellow ochre is going to fix that. So I'm going to speed through this whole process, but I am going to show you how to lift up the paint here, so that way. And I call, a lot of people make fun of me. Sorry for moving you here. I call it the scrubby scrubby method. And it's just with a stiff, slightly stiffer brush and some water, I'm going down here, and I am just using the ends of the bristles and just going back and forth and picking up some of that paint. That's what I love about watercolors, and especially these heavier watercolor papers, good watercolor papers. You can do this with good watercolor papers. You can't do it with the cheap junk that's out there. And there are even, I've recently discovered actually, 140 pound watercolor paper, because I've just experimented with it. I didn't realize I had really good 400 pound watercolor paper that can do this as well. So the problem is just that super cheap junk that you might find in different hobby stores or even Walmart. Pretty much, it seems like if it's watercolor paper that comes in a ream or a palette or anything like that, I hate to say it, don't use it. Because it's junk. Well, it's probably not junk for some people. There are some watercolor artists out there who do beautiful, awesome work with it, but it is not my cup of tea because I can't erase my mistakes. I like erasing my mistakes. Now, I'm trying to keep this texture of the moss. I've done some long areas. And I don't, you know, right now it looks very deliberate. So I'm just kind of scrubbing away very short little areas, lightening those up to kind of keep the texture of what I've got going on. And sometimes you need to vary up the different brushing techniques that you are using for pieces, such as scrubby scrubby. And scrubby scrubby has several different methods of use. Now, I am going over cleaning my brush off after so much and then coming back in with a completely clean brush. It doesn't do you any good to agitate these pigments, which is what we're doing. We are agitating the pigment so that way it's releases from the paper and then gets on our brush, and that's what's allowing us to move it around or even pick it up. But it doesn't do you any good if you are just moving it around and just putting it in another place and kind of homogenizing the whole area. And homogenizing, I mean basically now making it all one flat color. We need to lift. and we need to take it off because there's too much. So that way we can make room for some lighter colors to go in here to give the illusion of light. And I do hope you can hear my paintbrush. Now you can see it does kind of wreak some havoc on your actual paintbrush itself. Let's see if I can't get this to, probably can't get it to focus. Oh well. But you can see that that's not a perfect little round brush anymore, and that's because of this method that I'm using. So once I am done, I will pretty much sit here and try to shape him back and put him back into shape. So that way he will dry back to the way he should be. And you can also even use it a little bit lighter than probably what I'm doing. See, this is curving around the rocks, so I'm probably just going to touch a little bit more in this area, just a wee bit. Maybe a little bit right here. All right. Move this pigment around a little bit more. There we go. Now, I'm pretty happy with that. Maybe I might end up fiddling with this area a little bit. Kind of got... This is what I mean, homogenize this area here versus this feeling like a texture. That could be fixable though, so we'll see. And this is just straight yellow ochre. And I'm going back in here. Now a lot of this is wet, so this yellow ochre is going to pick up some of this green and kind of settle and mute itself down a little bit. And I want that, I don't want it to be pure yellow ochre. I want it to be kind of like what's going on over here. And we want it to blend in. Maybe some spring green. We'll test this and just see how it goes. And if I don't like it, it's the exact same technique to get rid of it. A little scrubby scrubby. Maybe go over it with the yellow ochre to turn, you know, kind of hide it a little bit, or to go over it with the darker green. And that will hide it. Now I'm liking that spring green so far. So I'm going to bring it down into areas like this, so that way it doesn't feel like all of a sudden, shocking, it's there and it's nowhere else. We want to kind of blend it into some areas just a little bit, so that way there's a unified appearance. And the bad cat's playing with the dog food. If you can hear that, I'm not sure. But he is the bad cat, so. Yep. That's not the bad cat. Bad cat just walked by. There's a mystery afoot. Who was in the dog food? I think it's Sammy. I've been noticing my cat, my little girl, she's actually been stealing my dog's dog food. I'm not sure why. It's one kernel is as big as her whole mouth. So I'm quite perplexed by this behavior, but she seems to find it very delicious, and she's spoiled, and she gets to do whatever she wants because she's my little angel. She doesn't do things like knock over lamps, so I really can't complain too much. All right. I'm gonna let this dry. I may yet go over this area and bring in a little bit more of the yellow ochre, but I might do it as a wash over the top. And something to keep in mind if you want to do that. If you've noticed in this background here, this background is also a lot lighter or a lot darker than what it was. And how I did that was I took some of my brown, I took some of my brown, made a very gentle wash with it. And a wash is basically a whole lot of water, a little bit of tinting of some pigment. And then I took a large brush and just brushed over it very, very lightly. You don't want to agitate the pigment that's already down. You just want to lay on top another pigment. And in order to do that, it's basically just a lot of water, big brush, and just very lightly and very quickly, barely even touching the page. You should not even hear your paintbrush doing anything. Going over the areas that you want to go over. Minus the ducks, because I'm happy with them. They don't need to be put more in the background. But I went over this whole area with a little bit of that brown to send it more backwards for me. And I may even yet do another glaze like that, and I might do a little bit of glaze with yellow ochre to get this going. So I'm going to need this to dry really, really well before I do that, because a lot of this pigment's already been agitated. A lot of it's still settling, because even if there's just a little bit of wet, your pigment is settling. Think of it as like sediment at the bottom of a, let's say a pond. You know how you walk out into a pond and you're walking through all that really soft mud in the bottom and it all gets stirred up? Well, that's what we're doing when we're using the scrubby method. We are stirring all that up, and that's our pigment clouding the water. Now we gotta wait for it all to settle before we put another layer over the top, and then it'll settle right on top of what we already have. I hope that makes sense to you guys. That's just some, I'm from the country, and that's just country way of thinking, but hopefully that makes sense to you. I really hope it does. So now we are going to give this lichen some love. And you know, I might even put a picture up of a, well, we're gonna test my video editing skills, and I might even put a picture of a lichen in there. We'll see how that goes. Probably poorly. It was a Sammy in the dog food. You naughty girl. And I want this to be fairly clear. I don't want it to overwhelm, because this is a fairly light colored thing that's from the region that these ducks live, the Harlequin duck, which is kind of like Washington, California, going up through Canada, up into Alaska area. So if you're from the Midwest like me, you have no idea about these ducks, but they're pretty. I did put quite a bit on my paintbrush, so those splotches are fairly big. And that's also because of all the water that is in this too. Now, to get the splotchier look, I've basically turned my paintbrush on its side, and I'm getting a little bit more of an elongated kind of print, as opposed to just using the tips of my brush. Flatten this out just a little bit by just laying my fan brush on top, because it's nice and wide. It'll help spread my pigments a little bit. There are other brushes you can use this for, but you can also use this guy to do this as well. And I think I want to use a little bit more of the springy green, which is what I use to get that mint color anyway. I'll mix it with some of this rust. We'll get a different shade of green going on in here, maybe, if it all behaves. Always remember with watercolors, a lot of the time, greens and blacks end up drying way lighter than what you put them down as. Now, if this was just flat white paper, the black still will, but the green, maybe not as much. But at this point, with all these other colors, this green's going to dry nowhere near as bright and vivid and neon as it may seem when I'm first putting it down. Now, because this is so wet, it's not going to have that texture that you saw when I first started. It is going to bleed outwards a little bit more. That is fine, because clearly what I had been doing before wasn't working for me. So I am trying a whole different method, and we will see once it dries if I chose the right method or not. Even when you are a professional watercolor artist or a professional artist, period, sometimes you have to experiment to find out. You don't always have all the answers. And it's just whether or not if your experimentation's pan out for you, I feel. Because I've never painted a lichen before, so. Okay, everybody, that's pretty much the end of this video, and very well may be the end of this entire painting set. I think we're pretty well done. I might still play with that lichen a little bit more. This is something that's just a problem that's not going to be resolved until way later. It might take me even a couple of weeks to figure it out. And that happens. I mean, you got to expect sometimes that's going to happen. So overall though, I'm still pretty happy with it, and I hope you guys enjoyed this video on the Harlequin Duck. I do believe my next video I'm going to be making is, ta-da, I'm actually going to try to finish this, which this will be posted, the glass painting will be posted long before you'll ever see this, because again, this is for a competition and I want to make sure that I'm not breaking any rules. So this is going to be posted like almost the end of the year. And then from there, after I get done with this one, I'm going to do a second entry for this competition, and we are going to do the cinnamon teal, another American waterfowl species that is just the most, I mean, if you think that this warm golden brown color, brown red color sienna is just gorgeous, wait till you see this duck. It is nothing but this beautiful, beautiful duck. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Please like, subscribe, and comment down below on things that you might want to see, pardon, that you might want to see in the future. If you want to learn just specifically feathers, leave it in the comments section. You want to learn more about making water effects, leave it in the comments section. I am more than happy to hear about anything you guys want to tell me. And if you guys have some tips for video editing and stuff like that, maybe things I should leave out or fast forward, do let me know that as well. If you find that, like my fast forward sections, if you have any tips or ideas or something, I'm always willing to listen to a helpful critique. As an artist, you got to get to where you love critique, because otherwise you're not going to get better. So, love you all. Thank you for coming and hanging out, and I will see you later. Bye!